Good morning, family. How's everybody doing today? Man, you could shoot a shotgun in here and not kill nobody. It is a thin crowd today. But you know what? I am excited that America is opening back up and people went on vacation. Come on. Yes, thank God to go somewhere, man. We were at a meeting this past week with pastors, and some of the pastors were saying, well, you know, we need to pray for our church. The church is struggling, and, you know, the passion's gone. I said, maybe it's not the passion's gone. Maybe they've been in jail for a year. Everybody's been locked up for a year. You didn't even know you were in jail for a year, did you? You've been locked up for a year. And so finally we're getting out, man, this week. You just love it. Crack me up. There's people everywhere this week with no mask and having fun, living life the best, living their best life. Well, I'm a rebel. I've been living my best life. I was not a masked person. If you are, God bless you. No, had no problem. I'm not one of those, what do you call that, the vaccinated. I'm not getting the vaccine. I'm not one of those guys neither. I ain't going to go get a shot for no reason. I told you what my Indian doctor told me that one time. She says, have you gotten your flu shot? I said, no, I ain't got no flu shot. You need to get that flu shot. I said, I ain't getting no flu shot. I ain't never had the flu this last year when I had cancer. I said, I ain't never had the flu shot. I got the flu. She goes, you've never had that flu. I said, no, and you're diabetic and you're fat. You should have that flu every year because you're in very, very, very hot spot. I'm like, hey, well, I'm going to come through this phone. This is going to be the first Zoom meeting where everybody got choked out. But then the other day, they put me on insulin. This was funny, man. They put me on insulin, and now I'm off again because I gained like 20 pounds. I was like, y'all didn't tell me I was going to gain weight on insulin. Let me off of this. So I got off, and the lady, same doctor, on the phone through Zoom. She goes, has anything changed since the last time we had talked? And I said, yeah, man, y'all put me on insulin, and I gained like 20 pounds. It's just, I thought your face looked so fat while we were on. I'm like, I paid her $50. Tell me how fat I was, bless God. Give my cocaine back, yo, heifer. Anyway, so I'd have told myself I was fat for $2 and went to Brahms and spent the rest on ice cream. So, hey, let's get ahead. Let's welcome our online campus this morning. Yeah. If you're watching online, oh, my gosh, people are watching online saying, that pastor's got no sense, and they don't know the half of it. But, hey, if this is your first time to be at TWC, don't judge me by the first 5 minutes. Let's see what the Lord has to say to us, man. But if you're blessed enough to go on spring break, have a good time, be safe traveling, come back. Now, next Sunday, I won't be here. Pastor Trish and I are speaking in Rio Doso at One Church. That's going to be a good time, so I'll be at Rio Doso next week. Playing the Outlaw next Friday. Glenn, be at the Outlaw, playing the Outlaw course. Yep. I don't know, man. I think the invitations come like dead men, one to a box. But we'll see what we can figure out. So I'm going to go play there and speak at the One Church on Sunday. Pastor Trish is speaking at a women's event. But I want to remind you, next Saturday at 3 o'clock, there's going to be a huge event out at Cook's Garage with Sean, how do you say his last name? Fute. There you go. Thank you. If you got nothing to do, show up out there. This guy's been going all over America doing outdoor worship services. People are going to get baptized. It's awesome things. So if you can be a part of that, you think that Trump rally was big, go check this out. It's going to be big. They're expecting about 10 to 15,000 people out there. So if you get a chance, go out to Cook's and check it out. Well, this is our final week in our series on Uncommon, and I hope that you've been blessed. I hope that you've learned something by it and that you've been challenged by it. But today, I want to talk to you about uncommon influence. And all of our areas of our life are affected by influence. And by that, I mean you can either grow your influence or you can lose your influence. How many of you know that? It's amazing to me. You can work 30 years to build something and then lose it in 30 seconds. So you can build it or lose it. And we've been using a theme verse, and here it is, Romans chapter 12 says, do not copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. In other words, if you think better, you'll live better, you'll do better. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good, pleasing, and perfect. And we've been saying that good relationships are possible They're just not probable. And the reason we say that is we kind of have a tendency to follow culture, and we kind of have a tendency to do things the way the world does those things, and the world's way is not the best way to do relationships at all. And so we need God's way. And when it comes to our relationship, do you know that studies show that 50% of all marriages are ending in divorce? That includes Christian and non-Christian, are ending in divorce. And so here at the Worship Center, we want to change that statistic. We want lives to stay together by doing things God's way. And in this series, I've already had testimonies of marriages beginning to change. And that's 100% possible if we'll do it God's way. I've had people come say, "Amen, I was on the verge of kicking him out, but we decided to stick it out and stay together through this uncommon series that God's doing something in me and God's doing something in him, and I know we're going to make it better together." And that's why we do what we do at TWC. I need half a church to come go with me this morning. Y'all too quiet. I feel like I'm at a Presbyterian church. Y'all too quiet. Got to look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, wake up." And look on the other side and say, "You too." Okay, I know y'all lost an hour of sleep. Y'all talking, y'all in here like it. Okay. But we've already had that happiness, and so we got to let God transform us. And according to scripture we just read, is when we do it God's way, we're going to know God's will for our life. And God's will for your life is something good, something perfect, and something pleasing. But in relationships, we have challenges, and we are going to have challenges. When we get hurt in relationships, we can have negative responses to that, and we begin to guard our hearts. But here's some common responses to pain. Number one, when I get hurt in a relationship, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to protect me. I am going to look out from uno numero uno, right? I'm going to check me out. And what do we do? I'm never going to get hurt like this again. I'm never going to go through trauma like this again. I will not ever, ever, ever. And Tommy, you know, ever becomes a long word sometimes. I will not ever, ever be taken advantage of by another man or another woman like this again. How many times have we done this in our relationship? We've made those comments right there. And really what these are their inner vows. And when you make inner vows, you have inner consequences as well. I'll never do this. And because you've made this vow, you can't love the way you need to love. And you can't be loved the way you need to be loved. We make inner vows, and that's why we have freedom class here at TWC. It's designed to help you with that, because as hurt happens, what happens? Walls go up. And it is hard to hug a wall. And it's difficult because we're building this prison to keep people from hurting us. And so I'll never. Let me put that brick down. I feel like this again. I'll never be treated like this again. I'll never do that. And we got this wall going up. But you know what? Nobody gets in. But guess what? Nobody gets out either. And you've built this wall. And then what we begin to do is we begin to decorate it. We hang pictures on it. And we try to convince us that it's better than what it is. No, a wall is a wall. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? And so if you're not careful, hurt people will hurt people. And so then the second thing from now on in every relationship, the second thing I'm going to do, I'm going to have to benefit. I'm going to benefit out of this relationship. There better be something in this for me. If me and you are getting together, you got nothing to offer, I don't want any part of it. If you don't have anything that I can gain from, I'm not interested in letting you in my life, which goes to number three, I got to have control. I've been hurt, so this time I'm going to control this situation. I'm going to lock this thing down, and we control by manipulation. We control by belittling one another. We try to tear down one another's confidence where we think that they can't get out and find somebody that'll treat them better than the way you're treating them, and they're getting what they deserve. It's called manipulation. And as control comes in, influence goes out. How many know that trust is gained in drops and lost in bucketfuls? But as control comes in, influence goes out, and finally we get to this one. We go, I'm going to win no matter what the cost. If I've got to ruin you, no matter what it does to my children, no matter what it does to my family, I am going to win. At the end of this, I am coming out on top. You may think you got something on me, buddy. You ain't got nothing on me. When this is all said and done, I'm going to leave you in the dirt. eye and coming on top. And I watched my dad over and over again be taken advantage of by people. It would blow my mind the kindness that my dad had, because I had to whoop somebody. Y'all not ready for me. Well, you a pastor. Look, I ain't got to preach but one day a week. Hello. pray for me. Anyway, they'd take advantage of my dad over and over again, and he'd get hurt by people. And you know what? Some of those people were his own family. His own family would just stick it to him. And I was like, ugh, Dad, let me just go over there and talk to him one time. But he continued. He wouldn't let what other people did to him cause him to be different than what God had called him to be. That was the most amazing lesson my father ever taught me, and he continued to do it over and help, and he'd help and help, and people would just, man, he'd loan people money and they'd never pay him back. He'd loan people money and they'd never pay him back, and he'd loan people money, and I'm just like, bro, what are you doing? Let's go whoop him. Let's go get our money back. And Dad says, they know they owe it. That's between them and the Lord. I said, but this is between me and them. I want to help you. It just blew my mind. And you know why it blew my mind? Because it was uncommon. It's uncommon to handle people the way my dad handled people, because when it happens over and over again, certainly later you think you're going to see some kind of response. And these things can happen to all of us. And the reason why is because we're dealing with people. How many times have you ever heard somebody, I love my job and it would be so much better if I didn't have to work with these people? And if you've never said that, you might be the person they're talking about. I just want to throw that out there for free. And somebody's like, oh, it never dawned on me. Yes, that's why you eat lunch by yourself every day. People's like, oh. Some people say like, oh, man, I love my family. If it weren't for all the people in my family. Right? When you go to the family reunion, you already know what's going to happen. Everybody going to get drunk. My family, my bad. At my family reunion, they're all going to get drunk, and then there's going to be a fist fight, and then somebody's going to be talking about somebody's mama, and it's like two brothers talking about their own mother, and I'm just sitting there going, both of y'all are right at the same time. Anyway, so y'all catch that on the way home. But we got people problems, and sometimes we are the people problem, if I can just be honest with you. And even Jesus had people problems. And so you said, no, he didn't. Look, the disciples were just normal people like everybody in this room. And Jesus had to deal with these guys. And there is more documentation, unfortunately, on this guy named Peter than there is any of the other disciples. And Peter didn't always do everything right. How many of you know that? He didn't always do everything right. And so I want to give you a list of people problems that you've probably had to deal with, because I bet some of the same issues Jesus had with Peter, you've had with other people. And here's the first one. People will disappoint you. You ever notice that? People will disappoint you, and it's going to happen, and you can't prevent it from taking place. It's just going to happen. Peter's out in the middle of the night, him and some other guys fishing on a buddy's fishing trip, and the storm comes up, and there's lightning everywhere, and all the stuff's going on. And it's totally pitch black out on the water, which is, I don't know why they'd be out there anyway like that, but they are. And the Bible says that something that looks like a ghost comes walking up. Like right there, I'm already scared. I'm just going to tell you, nobody's scared of the dark. They're afraid of what might be in the dark. And if I'm out there on the lake and something that looks like a ghost comes towards me, buddy, I'm jumping out the boat. I'm trying to swim back to the, I am a coward. I'm just going to tell you that. If I go take out the trash in the middle of the night, I take my pistol with me. I'm not going to get God. I'm not going to get God. It may be the neighbor's cat, but I'm not going to get God. I'm just telling you right now. And so he's out there, and this ghost walks up, and Peter said, I wonder if that's Jesus, or it must be Jesus. And he calls out, and he says, hey, Lord, if it's you, ask me to come out on the water. And Jesus said, come on out here, buddy. And so Peter walks out on the water, which is an amazing miracle. Can you imagine how incredible that must have felt to walk on the water? And I'm sure when he took his first step, it was kind of weird to be on water that goes up and down. But he kept on going. But in the middle of it, the Bible says he gets his eyes off Jesus. And as soon as he gets his eyes off of what his focus should have been on, he begins to go down. He begins to circle the drain. Anybody know what I'm talking about in here? And I think some disappointment must have come on Jesus because Peter took his eyes off of him. And he was just like, Peter, if you would have just stayed focused, if you would have just stayed in it, man, you could have stayed on top of the water. And Jesus said this to Peter, why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me in Matthew chapter? Why? That had to hurt Peter's heart. Why did you doubt me? But even in the midst of a miracle, I want you to catch this. In the midst of the miracle, there was some people disappointment. So sometimes things can go right and things can go good, but sometimes disappointment has a way of showing up when you least expect it. It was a miracle. Everybody, Peter's on water! And then we know that the other disciples were probably like, man, I'm glad we didn't get out there. Look at that guy right there going down. But there was some disappointment, which leads us to number two. People make mistakes. Life's just going to happen, man. People make mistakes. All of us make mistakes. It's a part of a life. And I know nobody's ever done this, but Peter gets in an argument with Jesus. Now, I know nobody's in here has ever argument with God. I know you never not. God, why? Why? Lord, what's going on? God, how could you let this happen? If you're so good, why do bad things happen? I know nobody's ever asked those questions here in this church, but the people that go to other churches, we need to pray for them because they're real people and they're probably going through that. And so Peter is argument with Jesus. Jesus is talking about going to the cross and going through this death. And Peter didn't want to hear none of it. He is not going to hear any of it. And he says, no way, this is not going to happen. And he begins to argue with Jesus. And this is a rough one because I want you to look at what Jesus said in Matthew 16. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. Now, you know you messed up really, really bad when Jesus calls you the devil. But people make mistakes, right? People make mistakes, which leads us to this. People are selfish. Now, this is one of my pet peeves. I can't stand selfish people, even though if I'm honest, sometimes being selfish is one of my spiritual gifts. You'll catch that on the way home when I'm talking about it. What I mean is we think we're not selfish until we are selfish. And I think we're more selfish than we actually ever care to realize. You're just not selfish about the things that are not important to you. Boy, it's getting quiet in here. I'm just, and so what do we say? I'm going to look out for me. All I do is win. At whatever cost it is to the other person, all I do is win. And when I go into the building, hands go up. And then I stay there. No, no, no. Up, down, up, down. Wait. Pray for me. See what goes through my head when I'm trying to preach? Help me, Lord, get past my own mind. But I'm going to look out for number one, and you're probably thinking of a person right now. Oh, my God, I know exactly who Pastor's talking about. PT, you hit the nail on the head. Oh, my God, as soon as I leave church, I am texting the link. I'm going to make sure they watch 9:30 service because they are the selfish people I've ever met in my life, and they're just terrible people, and they have supper. Listen, everyone in this room is the way they are for a reason. See, you're the sum total of life experiences. And I wonder what would happen if we tried to figure out why they were so selfish rather than just throwing stones at their selfishness. I wonder if we'd get an opportunity to minister to more people if we took time to figure out why they are the way they are than rather than just being fed up with them. Am I making sense to anyone? So they go to this supper and they got to go to garden and pray with Jesus. And Jesus, man, if he's really needing his disciples, it's after the Lord's Supper. He really needs these guys. He's fixing to go through the most difficult time in his life. And he's asking them, hey, guys, let's go pray. I need y'all to pray with me. And they fall asleep. They fall asleep after supper. I kind of get that part, you know. But they fall asleep in one of the most traumatic times in Jesus' life. And he says this. Peter, he's talking to Peter. You ever notice how Peter just has a way of showing up in all the Bible things? Okay. And Simon, he said to Peter, Are you asleep? And if you read Peter's character, I bet Peter's like, no, man, I'm awake. Watch Peter. No, I'm not. They are asleep. I wasn't sleeping. I was resting my eyes thinking about you, Lord. That's what I was. Read Peter's character. That's kind of what the answer he would have gave. He said, no, are you asleep? And then he says this, man, couldn't you even stay awake for 1 hour? I didn't ask you for a lot, buddy. But man, I'm fixing to go through something that's the biggest thing I've ever had to face in my life. And I really needed those guys that said they were with me to be with me this time. Could you not stay awake for an hour? And after all we've been through, after I let you walk on the water and we've done this and we've done that and I told you you're the rock, we've done all of these things. Now, you can't even make it an hour? What are you telling me, Todd? People are going to disappoint. People are going to make mistakes. People are going to be selfish. And number four, people sometimes might betray you. They might betray you, and that's when relationship is completely destroyed. And it's probably happened to some of you in this room. And it's probably happened to some people watching online. They know what it is to be betrayed. They know how devastating it is. And Peter, unfortunately, he comes to mind again. Again in this story, that because of the three denials. But you realize, if you go read, it wasn't just Peter that denied Christ. All of them scattered. All 11 ran. One had already turned, given him over. The other 11 all scattered. And in Mark 14 and 15, they come to arrest Jesus, and all the disciples ran away. After 3 years of spending all the time in the world with them, they up and leave like they don't even know him. And the ones who were closest to him ran away. You ever notice that the people that say that you're ride or die, or you're ride or die till tough things get tough? I cannot tell you how many people have said, man, I am with you, Pastor Todd. I'm with you no matter what. I am with you. And some of the same people that said they are with me no matter what didn't even make it till the next week. Because when bullets start flying, you find out who your real family is. Am I making sense to anybody this morning? Peter denies Jesus just hours later after promising, I'll never deny you. All these other guys may do it, but not me. I got a relationship with you like no other. I could see one of the other ones doing it, Jesus, but not me. In Mark chapter 14, he began to call curses. And he swore to them, I do not know this man. So he's not only, do you see what happened? Now he's got a mouth problem. He's not only in denial, he's cussing at people. Because when your car spins out of control, you either going to say, oh, Jesus, or oh, what's from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, right? He's calling down curses. And I'm sure Peter was like, man, I know this relationship is over. I know it's done. I've done the worst thing. And the Bible records that the last time Peter said he didn't know him, they're looking at each other face to face. They're looking at each other eye to eye. And Peter said, I told you, I do not know this man. And Peter, listen to this. You know what happens next? All of them go back to doing what they were doing before Jesus found them. Peter goes back to fishing, and he's out on the lake, and he's got shame and guilt for what he did. And make no mistake about it, if you don't keep going forward in your walk with Christ, you will always go back to what you used to do. When you get out, there's not like there's a new sex. There's not like there's new alcohol. There's not like there's new drugs. You always go back to what you know. It's like a dog going back to his vomit. Yeah, come on. Preach it. Come on. Why? Because the devil doesn't have any creativity. You're not hearing me. Only the Holy Spirit has the power to create. Jesus opened his mouth and created the heavens and the earth. The devil doesn't have the opportunity or the power to do that. So all he can do is keep tripping you up over the same things over and over again. That's how non-creative the Satan is. That's how boring he is. He doesn't have something new. But the sad part about it is he just keeps knocking you out with the same punch. It would almost be better if he had something new. Then maybe I wouldn't feel so dumb about going back to it over and over and over again. Are you still here? Yeah. And he goes back to what's comfortable. And I'm sure he's like, man, I've blown it. I've ruined the relationship. And if Jesus wasn't Jesus, he might be right. If Jesus wasn't who he really said he is, if he was like me, he might be right. If he was like me, he may not have been able to forgive. He would have been, that. You know what? I'm done with this guy. I told him what he was going to do. He said he's not going to do it. He did it anyway. I'm done. I've had enough. It's just, look, how many examples do we have of Peter just blowing it today? One thing after the other, just Peter just stuck on stupid. Can't get it fixed. I'm just done with this guy. Failure after failure, blown, mistake after mistake. But that's not at all how Jesus handled it. And if we let all the problems of the past relationships determine how we handle the potential of future relationships, we will lose and eliminate our influence. If we let what happened to us then walk into our now, we will never have a future because we'll always be dwelling in the past. You can't go forward and backwards at the same time. You can stay in neutral, and that's stagnation, and stagnation turns into dirty water, and dirty water starts stinking. See, Jesus didn't limit his influence in Peter's life, even as bad as it got right there. Jesus didn't give up on Peter, thank God. That gives me hope. I don't know if it gives anybody hope in here or watching online. This gives me hope. Jesus has not. I want you, if you miss everything I'm going to say, don't miss this. Jesus has not and will not ever give up on anybody on this planet. It's not in his character. It's not in his nature. And maybe that's what some of you need to hear more than anything this morning, is Jesus never gives up on you. I want you to let that sink in. Let it sink in. And as soon as I said that, you know what? The enemy's popping up and he's saying, he's not talking to you. That's for everybody else but you. And that's how you know that it's a lie, because the word of God's for everybody. But the enemy wants you to believe you've done too much. You've gone too far. Are you kidding me? This guy denied Jesus face to face. You realize, oh, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Jesus is demonstrating uncommon influence in Peter's life, and he prophesies to him in Matthew 16. Now I say to you that you are Peter, which means rock, and upon this rock I'm going to build the church, and the power of hell will not prevail against it. Come on, somebody. It will not prevail against it. You know what he was saying? Peter, even though you've messed up, even though you're flawed, even though you've made mistakes, even though you've blown it, I want you to know that I'm not giving up on you, and you are going to do some great things because I put great things on the inside of you, and only the one that made you and formed you and fashioned you. Jeremiah says you were fearfully and wonderfully made. Only one that made you can make you that kind of promises. Sure, you've made mistakes. Sure, you've made some bad choices and bad decisions, but what you've done is not who you are. Who you are is who God called you to be. You are better than the sum total failures that you've ever walked through. You're so much bigger than those things. I want you to hear me today. Uncommon influence is believing the best even after the worst. Doesn't get much more worse than denying the Savior. You understand that Peter could not mess up enough for Jesus to walk away from him. That's how much Jesus believed in him. And that's how much Jesus believes in everybody in this room. He will not walk away. One of their final conversations comes in John 21. And Jesus has died. Now he's resurrected. And he's doing some cool things. He's just popping in and out of rooms. Go read the word yourself. You're like, just walking through walls and doors and stuff. And he has this conversation with Peter in John 21, this New Living Translation. A third time he asked him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was hurt that Jesus asked a question a third time. He said, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. And maybe he asked him three times because Peter denied him three times. And we always look, people say, well, see, there's Jesus calling out the failures. He asked him three times. Maybe he's trying to build confidence in him. See, you only see, you see what you want to see through filters. And the reason you see that way is because the pain of your past, your mind automatically goes to the negative. Maybe Jesus is trying to build confidence in him. But Peter, now that you know I believe in you, now that you know your future is not dictated by your past, I want you to know that you're going to have influence going forward. How do you know that, Todd? Because look what Jesus said. He said, then feed my sheep. Doesn't talk about how many times he messed up. He just wanted him to use his gifts for the calling. Why is that important? Because I'm an old drug addict. That's so important to me because I'm an old fornicator. That's so important to me because all I want to do is get drunk and do stupid stuff. That's important. Do you love me? Yeah, then feed my sheep. Not do you love me and you've blown it and you can't, I can't use you. Do you love me? Yeah. Then let's go to work. Let's build the kingdom. That's so much hope, man. That's hope. That's hope. It's all about people. He said, I didn't spend 3 years of my life just so you could have some great memories, Peter. I have invested in you, and I believe in you, and I've forgiven you, and I've empowered you. Now go and change the world. Go influence the world. That's what Jesus had for Peter, and that's what Jesus has for everybody in this room. That's what Jesus has for everybody watching online in our relationships. Let me give you a definition. If you're a note taker, write this down. If you're not a note taker, write this down. If you don't have my notes, you can go to the YouVersion Bible app, and all my notes are on there, okay? Here's uncommon influence. My influence is not determined by my level of success, but by my ability to help you succeed. I want to read that again. Uncommon influence. My influence is not determined by my level of success, but by my ability to help you succeed. That is what uncommon influence is. It's always about somebody else. It's never about you. And that's anti-culture. I said that, and right off the bat, it's anti-culture because culture is all about me. Culture is I have to win, and it's totally opposite. And Jesus is about others winning. Jesus is about other people making a difference, about believing the best even after the worst. So how do we do it, Todd? If I'm going to do that, how do I have that influence? Let me give you four things, and I'm done. Number one, focus on them, not on you. Philippians 2, don't be selfish. You ever notice how the Bible just be mean sometimes? Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. It's crazy to me that we spend our whole high school trying to impress with people we don't even talk to anymore. Be humble. Thinking of others as better than yourself. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. In order to focus on the person, you're going to have to get close to the person. Shepherds should always smell like sheep. If you want to have uncommon influence, you're going to have to open your life and share your life with people. That's why at TWC, we don't do life alone. That's why it don't bother me if somebody comes in here smelling like a brewery.
Oh my God, they came to church, the pastor told us, I smell, this feels just like liquor. I could smell the alcohol. I was sitting three rows from them and they smelled just like alcohol.
Truth is, you want to know, hey, what was you drinking last night? No, I'm drinking.
I can't believe they'd come to church. Listen, I'd rather you come to church drunk than stay at home.
I can smell the marijuana from here. Well, where are they sitting? I'll sit. No, I'm just playing.
Pray for me. Old habits die hard. Bless God.
I'd rather them come here and smell like they've been baking in it all day than stay at home. Why? Because the word of the Lord never returns void. God can get you sober and just like that. I don't care what people come like. Just come.
Come. This is not a fashion show, and it's not a museum for Christians. Right? Find out what frustrates them. Find out what inspires them. And it takes closeness in order to do that. And we don't see people as a project. We see them as people. Well, the Lord's called me to help them. Maybe, but they're not a project. They're a person. And I know pastors and leaders that are afraid to let their... I know pastors that won't even let their other staff guys do anything in the church because they're afraid the guys in the church will look better than them. Number one, none of them look better than me. I want to say that right now. Like on the Santa Claus, remember Santa Claus? Who wouldn't want some of this? Anyway, so Trish is all the time, I'd like to put you on a plate and sop you up with a biscuit. Anyway, so, but they're afraid to let their light shine. They're afraid to let other people on their staff do anything. You know why? Because other staff members may gain influence and they're like pastors and teachers. Well, if I pour into them, they may leave my church and go start another church. Maybe, but if you don't pour into them, they might stay at your church and stay dumb. Pour into them, build them up, let God let them shine. Yeah. You think you're the only one that can do anything? That's a boring toolbox. Yeah. I want my guys to grow, and I'm sure there are things that they can do that are better than me. Off the top of my head, I can't think of one, but I'm sure there are things that they can do better than me, and seriously, I want to help them grow, and I want to, my son, listen, he's 21, he'll be 21 in August. I want y'all to pray for Hunter. Hunter is preaching for the first time at South this morning at 11:30. I love that, man. I'm so excited for him to be able to do that, to give him some opportunities. We tried to give it to Pastor Javi, and he punked out. He didn't want it. No, I'm just playing. He let Hunter go first. And so we'll pray for him this morning when you leave here. But we want to help people grow. When you help bring out the best of somebody else, can I tell you that God will bring out the best in you? If you'll help somebody else, God will bring out the best in you. Here's number two. Focus on the positive. This is tougher than you think because there's negative everywhere. Have you ever noticed it's negative? And most of the thing that comes out of our mouth, we're always telling people what they did wrong. We never tell them what they did right. Yeah. Ephesians 4, instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. If we're going to focus on the positive, we're also going to have to focus on forgiveness. Yeah. And people are like, oh, I'm pushed back. I'm not going to forgive them. I am not going to forgive them. Listen to me. We're going to have to overlook some negative things if we're going to grow into who God's called us to be. And I'm so thankful for people in my life that overlooked the negative in my life and made an impact. Whether it's my parents, my wife, my son, whether it's Pastor Jackie at Church on the Rock. I felt so proud this past week. I'm going to tell this story and there's probably some other guys watching and they're going to get their hearts or feelings hurt, but I don't care. Sometimes when you're the favorite, you just got to let people know. But we had E3 meeting over at Church on the Rock this week and there's a bunch of pastors. And Pastor Jackie's a lot like me. He's not a big hugger. I'm not a big hugger. As soon as he gets through with E3, man, he just comes up and just gives me a big hug. He says, so good to see you. And everybody else, he shook their hand. I was like, he don't love y'all like he loves me. Anyway, so, but you know what that did to me? That built me up right there. He edified me right in the middle of everybody and just built me up. This morning before I got here, I get a text from Pastor Jackie. That's just building me up. And my director from Lonnie Robbins, they all influenced me in a great way, but listen, you have an opportunity every day to be critical or be judgmental. Yeah. Every day you can be critical and judgmental, and those things are killers. And Jesus said, why are you looking at the sawdust in other people's eye when you got a beam in your own? You're trying to fix everybody else. Why don't you work on you? Let's fix you, and then we'll go look at somebody else. Focus on the positive instead of the negative. There's positive in everybody. Now, sometimes we got a mind for it, right? You know why? Because they've been so damaged and they've been so beat up, they don't think there's anything in there good. So sometimes we got to take up some dynamite and blow up all the negatives so we can get to the positive, right? Uncommon influence is focused on the purpose. Person forgives the negative, focus on the positive. Here's number three. Focus on their potential. Just like they have positive, everybody in this room's got potential. And most potential is not seen by them or easily recognized by you. We got to find it. We got to look for it. 1 Peter 4 says this, God has given each of you, somebody say each of you, a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them to serve one another. In other words, you're gifted to do something, not just go to church and suck air.
You're gifted to be an usher. You're gifted to be a parking lot greeter. You're gifted to be on the worship team. You're gifted to help in Kid City. You're gifted to help in Relentless. You're gifted to help in outreaches that we do here. You're gifted to go in missions. Well, I don't think I am. What, then God's a liar? I just want to throw that, well, Pastor Todd, you don't know my past. No, I don't know your past, but I do know mine, and I get to be on stage. Why? Because he didn't hold your past against you. Are you understanding what I've done? It's not that I didn't do everything that this world can say. Hey, we've seen Pastor Todd drunk. We've seen him high. We've seen him doing this, blah, blah, blah. Those things are all true. The only problem is, Brad, is when I got saved, Jesus took that negative took that negative reel and exposed it to the sun. And when that negative hits the light, it's not that the evidence went there. It just can't be seen anymore. And when I'm talking about sun, I'm talking about the S-O-N. Y'all not ready for me. Oh, let me go a little further. I'm almost done. Let me finish. Everyone around us has been given gifts. Even if you can't see them, they're there. And we need to use them well to serve one another, not just go to church. Throwing that out there. So I have to find the potential in people around me. You know Pastor Jimmy over at South Campus? You know why he's at South Campus? Because I saw the potential in him. He said, well, you think a lot of yourself, don't you? I said, no, hear me. Jimmy was going to be the oldest youth pastor in the world. Go ask him. He thought, I'm going to be a youth pastor forever. Until one day I set him down in my office. I said, Jimmy, I see something in you that maybe you don't see in yourself. He said, well, sir. He gets real nervous. Sir, what is it? And at that moment, I think I can say anything I want to. Yeah. I said, Jimmy, I see God calling you to a higher level. I see the Lord open up some new opportunities, and I'd like you to consider being the campus pastor over at South. And Jimmy said, oh, no. I'm good at youth ministry. I am a really good youth pastor. And he is. He's an incredible youth pastor. I said, you are. But Jimmy, I see something inside of you that God's calling out of you, and it's your time to go do what the Lord's called you to do. And he immediately, you know what he does? And this is what the majority of us, he starts giving me a list of why he's not qualified. Well, I've never done it before. Well, neither had I. If you always do what you always done, you always be where you always been. I can't do this. I can't do this. Jimmy, have you even stopped to think about what you could do? You're so busy talking yourself out of what the Lord's laid on you that you've already convinced yourself you can't walk into it. Pastor Javi, our youth pastor here, he was at a church. Their church was about the size of our youth group. And I called him to pastor our youth group. And he was like, I don't know if I could go. You wouldn't know it today, but this is usually a church about 1,500, 2,000 people go here. He's like, man, I don't know if I'm ready for that. I said, Javi, I see something in you that maybe you don't see in yourself, and I think you're bigger than Hobbs, Texas, or Hobbs, New Mexico. God forbid that be a Texas town. And you know what? Now he's over here being our youth pastor, and he's doing a great job. What are you saying, Todd? I'm saying that there is greatness in everybody, and some people just need to be reminded, and some people just need it called out of them. Your influence grows when you see in others what they can't see in themselves. Even the people you got friction with, if you can see past those things, then the next thing you can do, number four, is you can focus on their purpose. And every person, just like they have a spiritual gift, they have a divine purpose. God's got a plan for everyone, Ephesians chapter 2. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do good things, the good things he planned for us. Look, when? A long time ago. It's not like you got saved and Jesus goes, oh, I got to get a script together. I didn't know what they were going to do. He's like, oh, myself. And I see the wheels turning. Never. You're slow, but you're worth waiting on, bless God. He's like, oh, myself. I got to get a plan. No. You were fearfully and wonderfully made. He had a plan when he put you together. So we have to believe that about people around us. And I'm so grateful that my pastor, John Bryant, he called out there. I was on staff at Grace Assembly of God when he called out TWC and me. And can I tell you, if my pastor was still alive, he would love what's going on at the worship center. He would have the best time in it. Listen, you can cut an apple open and you can count all the seeds in an apple. But you cannot count all the apples that's going to come from those seeds. My pastor saw something in me I didn't see in myself. But sometimes that's what we're called to do. When you really believe in the person of someone, you will not stand by and let them fail. And sometimes those come through difficult conversations. My master's commission director, and back in 91, he had some of the hardest conversations ever with me. And I thought, all he does is ride my tail. I mean, this guy got nothing to do but just gripe at me every day. Nobody else in the class is getting yelled at and griped at and all that. And I'm the only one. There's 10 other people here. Go yell at them today. Give me a break. Give my tail end a break. Nobody's ever been there, just me. God, y'all are spiritual. And so I'm just sitting there doing that. But can I tell you something? If he wouldn't have done that back then, I wouldn't be on this stage right now. I wouldn't be here right now. Pastor Jackie, Dr. Sheets, they got some. Pastor Sheets, I met him one time. He called me on the phone one night. I was doing counseling over at South Campus. And he called the phone, me and Trish are in the middle of counseling. I said, hey, answer this phone. I don't know what's about. And Trish gets on the phone, and she said, hey, what's he? He said, where's Todd at? And Trish said, well, he's doing marriage counseling. He goes, I need to speak to him right now. Tell him it's an emergency. I was like, well, oh, my God, what's wrong? So I go get the phone, and Dr. Sheets says, hey, can you tell me why the pastor of the church is up there at 8 o'clock at night doing marriage counseling instead of at home taking care of his marriage?
I don't know. I don't know what to say to you, sir.
But can I tell you that I don't do marriage counseling at 8 o'clock anymore at night? And my marriage is doing better because I quit putting my work before my marriage. Come on. And I didn't like it when he said that to me. I thought, you don't even know me. Just because you pastor 2 mega churches, that don't make you somebody. I didn't say that aloud, but that's what I was thinking in his head. Because I love and honor Dr. Sheets. He's an amazing man of God. He's already forgot more than I've ever learned. I love that man. But because they love me, sometimes you got to have difficult conversations with somebody. I have those with my son sometime, and he don't like those conversations that we have. But can I tell you this? He would rather have that conversation with somebody that loves him than go to work that somebody just sees him as a check. My dad passed away 4 years ago, and it gets difficult for me this time of the year because my dad died right 2 days before Easter. Friday, he would have been 72 years old this past Friday, 72 years old. And I think, man, I wish my dad was here I could ask him this, and I could ask him this, and I can ask him this. But can I tell you the truth of the matter? There's not one situation that I go through the life that my dad didn't prepare me for. And not all of those were positive conversations. Some of those came on the end of a belt. Remember when we used to spank kids? We just put them in timeout. I'm just going to put them in timeout. You know what timeout was at my house? When daddy went from the right hand to left hand. Patriotic. He never served in the military, Brad, but he was patriotic. Daddy laid on the stripes and I saw the stars, bless God. let me close this out, man. I'm glad that when people had those difficult conversations with me, that they focused more on my purpose than they did my performance. I want you to catch that. Todd, I don't know what my purpose is, and we have hell for that. We do growth track every week. Listen to me. Your design purpose cannot happen separate from the body of Christ. I want you to catch that. Your design purpose does not happen outside the body of Christ. If it's not at the worship center, let me tell you, go find you a church where you can grow. If this isn't the one, go find the one. I don't care where you go to church, just don't go to hell. Right? Go find the church where you can grow and get invested in it so you can discover your purpose. And the last one, focus on the process. Why? Because it doesn't happen overnight. It's a process. A lot of people say, man, I want to have a church like you. It took me 24 years to get here. We started with 7 people in the living room. We didn't start with 1,500 and 2 campuses. 7 people in the living room. And 5 of them were my mom and daddy and them. God's on. Mom, daddy, Trish, and Hunter. We only had 2 converts. And they didn't know if they were coming back after the first week. I don't know. That guy's not very good. Listen to me. It's a process. Not everybody's process is the same. And it may not be easy, but as I look around this room and I speak to the ones that are online, your process may not be easy, but the process is worth it. Remember those old Westerns? And they said, there's gold in them there hills. There's gold in these seats in this room this morning. There's valuable things in this room this morning. There are valuable things that are watching online. And you got to get to the point when those around you begin to win and they begin to grow. When we invest in them, good things happen for us. Jesus summarizes all of what we talked about here in Luke chapter 6. He says, Do not judge others, and you'll not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it would all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give, and you will receive. Now, I want to stop right here and say this. This scripture is not about money. I've heard it preached about money. This is not about money. He's talking about people. This whole thing is about others. It's about people. Watch what he goes on to say. Give and you'll receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you give back. The amount you give determines what you give back. The amount of encouragement you give out determines what you're going to get back. The number of opportunities you give other people will determine how many opportunities you're given. The amount you invest in other people will determine the amount that people invest in you. The amount you put in your relationship is the same amount you're going to expect your spouse to put in that relationship. The amount you elevate other people is the amount they're going to elevate you. The amount you believe in them and push in them is the amount you're going to get back. It's uncommon influence. And the best way to love somebody is to help them become the best version of who God made them to be. Invest in them and God will bless you back. A man was once asked, his name was Billy Hornsby, and they asked Billy, man, Billy has never pastored a church, but he has encouraged thousands of pastors all over. In fact, when this man was dying, people from all over the world flew into the hospital just to get 2 minutes alone with him. Thousands of pastors from all over the world flew in to get just a couple minutes because he was weak, and they would tell him, hey, Billy's not feeling good. Don't go. And Billy would say, no, just bring him in. On his deathbed, no, just bring him in. I want to talk to him one more time. And they ask him, Billy, what are the greatest accomplishments in your life? We got to know. You've influenced thousands of people all over the world. What's your greatest accomplishment? And he said, my greatest accomplishment in life was somebody else's. That's uncommon influence. That's when you live your life to help others win. That's when you live your life to promote others. My ceiling is going to be my son's floor. He's going to do. I sit in vision cast with our staff all the time. I went this last week and we went around the north side of town to look for another campus to plant because there's nothing on the northeast side of Lubbock, and so I'm looking for places to plant another campus. I got to find a pastor that can preach in Spanish first to go over there. And Jimmy Kane, he's a faux Mexican. He's a Taco Villa one. And so we got to find one that can do it. And I'm going to plant it and go over there. But I'm casting, and we're talking about building another building at South Campus because we have a lot of acreage over there. Building a broadcast center in that one, and just a bunch of stuff. And people ask, Todd, you're 50. Are you sure you're going to get to do it all? I said, I don't know, but I'm going to cast it all. Amen. I'm going to cast all that I got, and I'm going to invest in my son, and I'm going to tell my son who he can be and what he can do. And I'm going to tell all my pastors on my staff what they can do and who they can be. So if I'm dead and Jesus hasn't come yet, legacy is still happening. Okay? But the only way that happens is if we use our uncommon influence to pour into others. I had so many men and women pour into me along the way. I'm so thankful for each one of them. Because I didn't see in myself what they were. They were telling me I was anointed when I was stoned. And I was like, that's not anointing. That's cocaine. No, we know you're a drug addict. But there's something about your life. And I was like, y'all are crazy as all get out, man. There's nothing special to me. And my goal at that time, I want to hear you because I think some people have the same story. I was going to split hell wide open. I thought, my church told me I was going to hell for going to the movie. They told me I was going to hell for wearing shorts. And I thought, well, if I'm going to hell for that, I'm going to go big time. Go big or go home, bless God. And man, I did everything I could do to get God to leave me alone. And I would just tell him, leave me alone. I don't want to hear it. Because I go to church and the church is just mean and all the people in the church are mean and hateful. I don't want to be alone. If that's Jesus, I don't want none of it. They know more about what they're against than what they're for. What are y'all for? Well, you know, we're for you not wearing shorts. We're for.
What's up, Jack? Good to see you. That's one of the men that invested in my life. That's my old youth pastor right there. What an honor to have you here, man. Don't go up to him afterwards. He'll testify about me. Because he knew me when I wasn't right with Jesus. But you know what? When I started preaching, he gave me a shot. He let me go to Mule Shoe, Texas, and preach a youth revival for him one night. I was like, I can't believe you'd call me. And he said, well, I called 10 other people, and they didn't answer, so I'm down to you. But I did everything I could do to get Jesus not to love me. And there was nothing I couldn't do. I couldn't sleep with enough women. I couldn't snort enough coke. I couldn't smoke enough weed. I couldn't drink enough Coors Light. And he would still try to talk to me. I'm like, dude, what do I got to do to get you to leave me alone? Like, seriously, I am running out of money. It's funny, but I'm being honest. Drinking my baby goodbye. I'm running out of money. I need you to stop. You know what he said to me? He said, Todd, I'm never going to stop coming after you. And I said, why, dude? Like, I am not a prize. I am not a prize. He said, that's because you're looking at yourself the way you see you. You don't know the thoughts that went through my head while I was putting those fingerprints on your thumb. Because nobody in this room has one the same. Nobody that's ever born has ever had a fingerprint like you. He said, man, when I was putting this together, I knew what you were going to do with that hand. I knew sometimes you were going to nail spikes. I knew sometimes you were going to press thorns. But I knew if I just kept pursuing and kept pursuing and kept pursuing, I knew that we could turn what the devil meant for bad and make it good. I knew we could do it, Todd. And you know what? That's my story. And you say, you ought to be ashamed of your past. I am. But I'm more interested in you hearing about the goodness you... That's a nutshell of my past. The last 29 years of my life, actually. I've been married to my wife, same woman for 29 years. I know, she's lucky to have me. And I've been preaching for 30 years. 30 years preaching the gospel. And you know, at one time, I went to the Lord when it kind of got, I'd served the devil as much as, and sometimes if we're not careful, we'll serve the devil better than we serve God. But I got to that point, Brother Jack, and I finally said, man, I have lived for you longer than I've lived for the devil, and I've done some good in my life. And you know what the Lord said to me? Todd, you did good on day one. I wasn't counting the years that you started serving me. I saw the end before the beginning. It's the day that you said yes that I want you to hear me, man. That's what's on the table today, is uncommon influence, that God would take all the mess and all the mistakes and all the junk and use it for his good. I'm sure, can anything good come out of an East Side boy from Lubbock, Texas? Most of the people would have said no. They said, can anything good come from Nazareth? Philip said, I don't know. Just come see. Just come see. And listen, there is gold in them there seats this morning. There is treasure in the house. There is influence in the house. And there are people that you're going to reach that I'm never going to get to speak to. It's your testimony that's going to change them. Because they know all the good and all the bad and all the ugly. And they're like, I seen you at church with your hand raised in. I seen you on Friday night with a beer can raised in. And what's this and this? Man, pray for me. Instead of throwing rocks, would you just pray for me? Till this becomes my posture. Ah, shandayarabaso. Let this become my posture. I know I freaked some of you out praying in the spirit. I'm sorry. People are like, what's he doing up there? This is a Holy Ghost spirit-filled church. I just want you to know that. If you don't want to hear speaking in tongues, go to one of them dead churches, okay? There's a bunch of them. And some of them claim to be spirit-filled.
Calvary Church. Here's what's on the table today. Uncommon influence. To stop where you've been, to turn around and start going something new, and taking your story and using it for His glory, taking your mess and making it a message. I want every head bowed. No one looking around, because this is nobody's business. You're here today and you've seen, you know what, Todd? Man, I've blown it. Golly, I've blown it. I can tell you a whole lot of things I've done wrong more than I can tell you what I've done right. Well, I want to stop you right there. I want you to quit focusing on what you've done wrong. I want you to quit focusing on how many times you messed up, and I want you to focus on God's grace here this morning. You're here and nobody's looking around. You'll just be honest. You say, you know what? That message is for me this morning. I got some things I need to change. Yep, I see that hand. Who else? Yeah. Even if you don't come forward and let us pray for you, let me just see your hand this morning. Yeah, yes. There we go. Praise God. Amen. I got you all the way there. Yep, chair right there. Yep. So you raised your hand. I wonder if you'll take another step of faith. Maybe you're here and you would like somebody to pray with you. I want you to get up and move. Right now, we got our altar workers here. Don't wait on anybody else. This is your prayer request. This is your season. We're not here to judge you. What will people think if I come to an altar? Man, the same thing you when you go to a doctor, you're sick and you need some help. Nobody cares what the sickness is. We just want to get you the help you need. Anyone else? You're worth waiting on, man. Don't put off to tomorrow what you can do today. You're not here by accident. You're here by divine appointment this morning. And what you've done is not who you are. What you've done is not who you are. They're still coming. I'm going to pray for you because a lot of hands went up this morning. And I want you to know that God knows what each one of those hands mean. First off, Holy Spirit, I thank you for the convicting power of the Holy Spirit. I thank you that you come in the room, Lord, not to beat us up, not to tell us what kind of failures we are, but to encourage us that our past is just that. It's just the past. And today is a new day for those that choose to fall in love with Christ Jesus. Lord, I can't pray this prayer for them, but if you're here this morning and you know you need to get right, just ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Invite Him into your heart. And then ask Him to empower you not to live the way you've lived that way before. That the power of the Holy Spirit would come alongside of you. That's the greatest gift you have, to help you, to strengthen you, to do those things that you want to do, that you know you shouldn't be doing. That He'll come in and say, man, you don't got to do that anymore. You don't got to go in there. You don't got to say that. You don't got to behave like that. I know that's what you've always done, but that's not who you are. Today's a new day. Today's a new start. And if you fall and if you fail, man, don't beat yourself up. Don't beat yourself up. I knew I couldn't make it. Listen, we're all going to make mistakes. But when we make a mistake, we don't run from God. We run to Him. Lord, here I am. Search me. Know me. If there's anything wicked within me, pray for me, Lord. Forgive me for all of my sins and everything that I've done. Help me to be the man or the woman that you've called me to be. And so, Lord, right now, on top of that prayer, we call out the gifts that are in this room. And we call those to attention right now in the name of Jesus. We come against shame, guilt, and condemnation. For your word says there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. I can't help where I've been, but I choose where I'm going. We call those gifts to attention this morning. And we say, take us and use us for your glory. For we don't belong to ourselves. We belong to a King. We thank you for the saving power of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that makes these kind of prayers possible. In Jesus' name I pray. And the whole church said, amen. You feel like you've been to church today? Amen.